Well, there's a couple of reasons mentioned in the applications. I started to do work with internet type of things in early 82 in Europe, and that was first. First we did it internally, and then later on we decided, well, let other people enjoy the fun. And so we started having other friends of various other institutes connecting up. And before we know, we became one of the major hubs in Europe, and also known as MCFACS or MACFACS, which is actually the Scottish friends called it. And so it became a kind of a center where everybody was connecting to. And and later on we got the first real Atlantic line, things like that, over the ocean. And so in getting that working was kind of an interesting affair. And it all started with the other Hall of Famer from the same institute, Teus Hagen. He was the kind of pushed people into, and I mean, he basically asked me, can we do this? And I looked at the paper and said, yeah, let's do it. And so that's how it kind of started. That's, telecommunications, every country had its own state. Communication, they owned basically the telephone and telephone lines, and you were not allowed to transport any information for third parties over those lines, which was it was actually a regulatory stumbling blocks, trying to find ways how you manage to do stuff. And but the European market was slightly going to get slightly looser, and so we got kind of although it was against the law, I mean, kind of a permission of doing experiments. Experiments are great because then the government can always say, oh, it's just an experiment, we stop it. And when it's good, they have been allowed to do these things. I was a very bad student, and later it was actually discovered I was dyslexic, but at that time nobody really noticed that. I was just not doing stuff. And a mother of a friend of mine, when I failed again going to the next level, she kind of helped me out with understanding how mathematics worked. I mean, she realized that I was just not getting it. Read it, but not translating it to the real action, how you deal with it. And she learned me how to do this stuff, and which is kind of really hand. And I think that's a big contribution, because she actually learned me how to think from what's sitting on the paper to more an abstract level of how to deal with the material. So that was a great boost. So kind of my school career marched on, not very quickly. But I think that was kind of a turning point, personally. And Mrs. Albada, and so I'm still very thankful for her that she did this. If you go back to the beginning, when we started out, we were not really, we were just playing around and trying, finding out about the technologies, and had no idea where it would end up, like it is today. And now today it's things like, it's become way more entertainment and media vehicle than just exchange information about your latest research. And the enormous amount of money got involved with, and we never realized what we're doing at that time. And so that makes it also difficult to say anything about the future, because one thing is sure, whatever you say, it will be different. You will see the people take it for granted. And The economical interest in network is raising. And that's why governments are getting more and more interested in controlling it, because they don't like to be dependent on things they don't control, because then the voters will say, well, why didn't you fix this? Why now it broke? And one of the one of the problems of doing everything over the internet is that the old systems stopped working. So, in, for instance, the banking in the Netherlands had their own complete own system for connecting all the ATMs with each other and with the banks and so on. It's a complete separate network, so it didn't matter whether or not the internet was working. Now it's all gone, it's all over the internet, and suddenly people want to have demands on the internet where it was never being made for. And and now suddenly want to very strict control, because they want actually want the old back network back, but then without doing any investments. And so that's a tendency getting more and more control about that. Well, don't get intimidated by us old guys. And I mean, go ahead, make things work. And I mean, can-do mentality should work. And I mean, that's kind of go out, explore. And that's don't get too hang up about what the existing systems are. I mean, I find it great to see that people are doing things we never thought about. And I mean, then one thing, you know, don't make the same mistake we did. Yes, make new ones. Well, as I said, people are using it for, you know, entertainment, and the real entertainment industry is now getting dependent on the internet. And things like Netflix, I mean, they wouldn't exist about without the internet and the invention of the internet. That's kind of surprising to me. That's always been kind of weird. I mean, that's and so. Yes, but what I also also didn't really, so people talk about the internet like, you know, this is the way of doing democracy for everybody and everything, and the only thing is a cacophony of noise which is going to, and people in the social media pain in with that, because nobody's listening, everybody's just shouting, and that's not going to help anybody. And so that's but some constraint in that area would be nice, but that has come from people. I mean, that has, you cannot have that done by governments or whatever. That's the goal. You see people, well, you should restrict that. I mean, the whole idea about trying to find out what fake news is or not. I mean, well, I mean, it's just like phishing. It's like people should be slightly more critical about what they see. It's not only fake news on the internet. It's also in the newspapers. I mean, look at the silly weeklies that come out, and the Elvis Live stories, and I mean, these were already before the internet and still lives on. And so some more critical, but by more sense at people, that would be nice to